This verse and this episode is about the creation of the sky and the earth. And first, I want to ask my dear guests your opinion and or what do you think is the meaning behind this holy verse. I'll start with you first, with you, Abdurrahman Ismail.
I believe that this verse is a display of God's kindness. Despite the fact that God is the creator of everything, He is reasonably and kindly asking people to contemplate in His creation rather than forcing them into believing in Him. He is telling them, I'm the creator of everything. I have created this miraculous earth, and I have turned afterwards to the heaven and fashioned it into seven firmaments. And this is the way you have to believe in me, because I'm your creator and I'm the omniscient creator.
Yes. What about you, Muhammad?
I agree with Rahmania, yeah. Mm-hmm. And the fact that this ayah specifies that Allah Ta'ala, He created so many species,
yes,
on this earth, and everything on this earth and the sky. And I'm just one of them. We are just, mankind is just one of them. And He created all of this for us. Okay? Tells us that there is a big purpose of us,
yes,
being here.
Mm-hmm.
Allah Ta'ala creating us. And then obviously the ayah also says about Allah having all the knowledge, because He is the creator.
So basically what you get out of it is more about the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah. Do you get any scientific aspects of the ayah?
Yes. I see that he has fashioned the earth, okay, specially. And
yes,
and I see that is slightly in the whole universe. You see that the earth is different from everything, and our life is different from everything.
Yes.
And we are at a balance, mm-hmm, you know, at a very specific balance.
Yes.
And that I see that he has mentioned that he has taken pain and he has done this specially.
Yes. Abdurrahman, the unseen or the unseen parts of the science and the earth and the sky, how when you listen to the ayah, what do you really imagine?
Well, the ayah tells me basically about the sequence of creation. Allah has started with creating the earth, and then He turned to the sky for something I don't know. Maybe Dr. Zaghloul will.
This is a very important point that we will have to return to Professor Zaghloul at the beginning, the sequence.
Yes.
Which is a very important point.
You see, this verse actually was misinterpreted by some of the commentators. Some would say, does this mean that the earth was created before the firmament for the sky?
Yes.
Actually, the creation took place in one go. Because we know with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His word be and it will be. You
yes.
See. So even scientifically, we can see today that the process of creation of the heavens and earth happened simultaneously at exactly the same time. Because none of these two entities could be separated from the other.
Yes, and time is not an element into the creation.
No, the time, of course, we as human beings, we are controlled by time.
Yes.
But Allah is above time and above space. Subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Yes.
And neither time nor space can delimit the identity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Yes.
So He can order things be and it will be. And the beauty in the verse, it emphasizes the fact of creation. As Abdurrahman said, it emphasizes the fact of creation. Because at the beginning of this century, or even earlier, since the days of Renaissance, science developed in the West by a challenge between the church and the scientists. And scientists were persecuted quite a lot. And finally, science emerged as the giant in the West. And science started by a complete divorce with religion, complete divorce with the church and with religion at large.
And I think it's an ongoing fight.
But
until now, you find aspects of science that a lot of scholars, religious scholars, would think it's against religion.
No, but you see, it's the tailoring of the scientific notions,
yes,
by atheists or agnostics. They gave it the flavor of not believing.
Yes.
You see, but really, scientific achievements at a climax of today are supporting every single scientific notion in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So at the very beginning, you could see negation, complete negation of creation. They say this universe is eternal, and they produce what they call the steady state theory.
Yes.
That the universe is eternal. It had no beginning, will never have an end. And nowadays, scientists try to assess at what time the universe was created. And they are giving calculations. And they believe that the universe was created around 13.5 billion years ago.
Yes.
And when the Earth was created, when the Moon was created. And we believe that this took place in one go. So, if you read a classic book in geology or in astronomy, they used to have the slogan, there is no vestige of a beginning nor sign for an end. Now they are trying to calculate the beginning and also trying to calculate when the end will be. So when the Quran speaks about creation, you see, these latest scientific discoveries substantiate the fact that this universe is not eternal. It had a beginning. And everything with a beginning must have an end. So this testifies to the fact that the universe and everything that's in it was physically created. Yes. Secondly, the Quran differentiates between the early creation of the heavens and the earth and the later differentiation of the earth, the one earth into seven earths, and the differentiation of the one firmament into seven firmaments.
Yes.
And that's why this verse, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا. It is He, Allah, the Lord of that universe, who has created for you everything on that earth, you see. ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فَسَوَّهُنَّ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ. After the creation, then He started the differentiation. He made the earth into seven earths and made the sky into seven skies. And the verse ends by saying that وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٍ. And Allah is knowledgeable of everything. Yes. This is His work, His creation. He knows everything, you see. And that's why the beauty here is the emphasis on the fact that everything was created, that everything must have a creator. This creator has to be above His creation. Neither matter nor energy can shape His identity. Neither space nor time can delimit that identity. And this is what we can get out from this beautiful cosmic verse in the Quran.
Okay, Professor Zaghloul, we'll take a very short break and return back to explain further into this ayah. So stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. You're watching Quran and Science with Professor Zaghloul Naggar. Doctor, at the beginning, you were speaking about some of the misled scientists. And I was thinking, is the Holy Quran providing any sort of boundaries of thinking for scientists, or is it providing more than that?
You see, actually, if you read the Holy Quran, you could see many controls and regulations about the activities of thinking, of analyzing, of looking and meditating. You see, even the fair Westerners who speak about the history of science admit clearly that the scientific method, which is wrongly related to some Westerners, they say that the scientific method is purely a Quranic method. Because the Quran is always asking for the evidence, for the proof. The Quran is negating judging by whims and personal whims, you see, and conjecture, you see. The Quran is always asking, present your proof. قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ. You see, and the Quran is defying the fact that one would follow blindly in any area, not necessarily the area of religion, in any area. You have to use your faculties. You have to use your senses. You have to use your brains, you see. And that's why the Quran laments completely, أَفَلَا يَتَفَكَّرُونَ أَفَلَا يَعْقِلُونَ أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ أَفَلَا يُبْصِرُونَ. Don't they even see? Don't they even think? Don't they even meditate? Don't they even reflect, you see? So really the scientific method is basically a Quranic method. And that's why it was introduced by the early Muslim scholars. And They try to relate it to some Britishers or the other, which is completely unfair and untrue. So the Quran has laid down the rules and regulations of indulging into any scientific endeavor, any way of thinking, any way of analyzing anything. So the controls are there. We have to stick to it.
Okay. Okay, moving to you, Abdurrahman and Muhammad. Abdurrahman, do you have any further questions related to the creation of earth and the sky?
Well, in this verse, the word used in Arabic to refer to earth is al-ard in Arabic, which may refer either to land or earth. What do we mean here? Does it refer to planet earth or to all the planets? Or?
No, you see, earth here means our planet. The planet we are living on. But the word al-ard, meaning earth, comes in the Quran with three different meanings. If the Quran is comparing the earth with the moon, for example, or with the sun, or with the constellation, it's the total planet. If the Quran speaks about vegetation and the influence of rain on the soil, it is the soil section. If the Quran speaks about al-ard with the meaning of places you are living on, or places that are rifted or affected by deep falls, it's the outer rocky layer which we are living on. So we have these three meanings: the total planet, the continental masses we are living in, and the soil section that's covering the continental masses. And the exact meaning can be understood from the sequence of the verse, the context of the verse. Yes.
How about you have mentioned earlier that there are seven layers of earth.
Yes.
Does that refer to planet earth also or to another?
You see, our earth is actually composed of seven enveloping layers, seven different levels, you see. The internal structure of the earth says that there is a solid inner bowl of iron and nickel, which is known as the solid inner core of the earth. And then we have a liquid outer core. And then we have four layers of mantle. And then we have the outer rocky cover of the earth. Any earthquake, natural or experimental, can define the boundaries between these seven different earths very precisely. Because the sound wave or the shock wave, as it traverses from a highly dense body to a lighter or lesser dense body, it breaks. So it defines these boundaries very precisely. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has actually mentioned this. He said in an authentic hadith, "Man اغتصب شبرا من هذه الأرض خسف به يوم القيامة إلى سبع أرضين." Whoever would snatch a hand length, you see, from this earth unjustifiably, unlawfully, he will be thrown down to the equal distance, equal area, you see, from seven earths. He will be surrounded by the same area from seven different earths. Or خسف به إلى سبع أرضين. He will be thrown down to the same area from the seven earths. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is also quoted to have said, إذا سجد المؤمن وصلت بركة سجدته إلى الأرض السابعة. When a true believer prostrates, the blessings of his prostration reaches the seventh earth, which implies that these seven earths are enveloping each other. They are all within this earth, and the outer one is enveloping the inner one. And inasmuch as we have seven earths enveloping each other, we have seven firmaments enveloping each other. And as I said earlier, Allah created in the beginning one earth and one firmament. Then he differentiated this one earth into seven earths and differentiated the one firmament into seven firmaments.
Okay. Doctor, you said that Islam actually uplifted the science, which was kind of dead in the Dark Ages. You heard about the Dark Ages.
Yes.
And Islam and the Muslims, who, with the knowledge of this Quran, which was revealed in Mecca, they uplifted the scientific knowledge.
Yes.
And to my mind, an example of algebra, which is the basis of mathematics, comes to me. Can you please put some light on this?
Actually, although this is a little bit away from what we are discussing, but I would like to emphasize the fact that the Islamic civilization was the longest and the most integral civilization in the history of humanity. Why do I say that? Because it continued from the early part of the 7th century until the 18th century. Muslims were the bearers of the flag of scientific knowledge in every field for more than 10 continuous centuries. And this never happened before in the history of humanity. Secondly, the Islamic civilization was the only civilization that took this world and the world to come in one equation. See, currently, all humanity is suffering from the fantastic scientific and technological developments which is paralleled by negation of religion, moral decay, dissociation of the society, many wars and many fightings, many bloodshed, many injustices that are taking place in this world. And actually, man can destroy himself by developing scientifically and retreating religiously and morally and ethically.
Okay, any further questions, Muhammad or Abdurrahman?
I have a small question. Some people would say if we establish a link between science and Quran, there could emerge a problem in the future because, as you know, science is always developing.
Yes.
I mean, if there is a scientific theory now, it could change in the future.
Yes.
And if we link the scientific theory to Quran, we would say that this theory or the Quran was wrong, and yes. This is also...
You see, I wrote a small booklet called قضية الإعجاز العلمي في القرآن الكريم وضوابط التعامل معها. The scientific inimitability of the glorious Quran and the controls on dealing with it. And I put 20 different items in the process of controlling how to write, how to deal with the topic. And the most important one of them is that in the area of scientific inimitability of the Quran, I cannot use a theory. I cannot use a proposition. I have to use established facts. Because this is an area of a challenge to Muslims and non-Muslims alike. And if you are challenging, you have to be standing on solid grounds. I cannot use a theory because a theory may fail, may be proved incorrect, you see. But I have to use established facts. And when science reaches the level of a fact or an equation, you see, it does not revert. You see, it can be enlarged, it can be expanded, but it does not go back against its own principles, you see. So in the area of scientific inimitability of the Quran, one of the conditions is that you should never ever use a theory or a hypothesis because these are liable to fall down. I can only stick to established facts.
Professor Zahrul Naggar, we really thank you very much for being here with us. It was a pleasure having you in this edition of Quran and Science. I also thank Muhammad and Abdurrahman for being here with us and for your interaction. And with this, we come to the end of this edition of Quran and Science. We thank you for watching. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.